A very warm good afternoon to the judges present here. We are here to discuss the case visa inclusive case, a sought after visa for entry in China's electronic payment and strategies beyond for the Chinese as well as the international market for visa. We welcome you judges. We are Bharat Consultancies from Sri Ram College of Commerce. We have here Madhurima Jaiswal, Avneesh Bayani, and Agrata Gupta.
We begin the analysis of this case with a micro-analysis of visa. Basically, we've broken down the sources of revenue as given in the case. What are the sources of revenue for visa? Service revenues, data processing revenues, and international transaction revenues. Basically, what visas does is it offers a platform for settlement of transactions. It does this through offering services for debit cards, credit cards, prepaid cards, or commercial payments. What we've done here is a SWOT analysis of Visa. One of the strengths is the worldwide network, trust, and acceptability, which is a very strong point when you want to settle transactions of huge amounts. Another one is robust financials. They've been making profits for years at an end now. The third one would be support for diverse options, like e-commerce, like normal card payments, credit cards, debit cards. What are the weaknesses of Visa? The weaknesses of Visa are the high transaction costs, which we'll subsequently explore in the case. The low adaptability to cultural markets, especially the Chinese market, which again, we'll address. Thirdly, the restrictive policies and practices. They've been at the receiving ends of a lot of antitrust cases, which we will discuss. The opportunity in the market right now would be the Chinese accession to WTO and the promise of full access to the Chinese financial markets. Whether we can tap onto this opportunity or not is again something we'll discuss subsequently. The threats in the market right now would be no permission to process the renminbi-dominated transactions, the CUP-compatible card devices which have been installed in China throughout, making it a very easy transaction platform, and thirdly, the regulations in the Chinese market. Next slide, please. Here we analyze basically what CUP has been doing. It's a very, very aggressive expansion strategy, and we've also enumerated the strengths which enable them to expand in such a way. As you can see, CUP started from Beijing with ATMs and POS terminals. Subsequently, it expanded to Europe, Australia, Southeast Asia, finally coming down to Asia Pacific with Citigroup issuing renminbi-dominated cards. One of the strengths of CUP would be the low transactions cost, which matters a lot in a business like transaction processing. Secondly, the same day exchange rate, which again is something Visa is not offering as of now. And the exclusive right for renminbi transactions as offered by the Chinese government. It would also be a robust network, which CPU currently enjoys in China. So,
over here, we will be analyzing the Chinese industry, which is a micro-analysis. Here, we've created a three-force model, where we are talking about how the industry is affected by the buyers, the rivalry, and the entry. The buyers initially constituted 17.9% of the share. They were initially reluctant, but now the market share of the buyers is increasing. As we calculated, which was about 154% in the car payment value. And this industry has a short history. When we are talking about the rivalry, CUP is our major rival, where it is having a share of 85.9% of the market. And the entry in the Chinese market is restricted and regulated. Here we've done a global market analysis. We have figured out that it is a duopoly where Visa has a 39.8% share and the MasterCard has 22.2% share, which is creating a thwart competition from the small networks. There is emerging competition from CUP and the American Express, where CUP has 11.4% and 6.7%. But we also realized that CUP is ranked 1 in terms of the number of financial cards, and it has about 29.2% share, whereas Visa is not behind. It has 28.6% share and MasterCard has 20% share.
Now we come to the problem statement of this case. So basically now let me give you a brief introduction. Visa has been a company which is into facilitating online payments through credit cards, debit cards and other means, and it has a long history and it has been doing great business. And its diluted EPS, which we calculated, has been growing quite significantly and it has been doing pretty well. But now the problem is that China, which is, as we see, the Chinese market, it is huge in size in terms of economy and in terms of the population, and it is a promising market which promises a lot of growth in the years to come. And now the CUP problem. The Chinese have adopted a restrictive policy whereby they are not allowing the foreign companies to offer renminbi transactions in China, but are focusing, they have to just restrict themselves to foreign currency transactions, not renminbi in China itself. So which is a significant problem. Now this leads us to the WTO conflict and the WTO resolutions. This is actually a violation of the WTO draft agreement which they entered into earlier. But now, as a company, we cannot base our decision on what is going to happen in WTO. In WTO, there are a lot of factors involved, the political factors, the geopolitical factors, the USA, China. So we are kind of ignoring that. As we'll proceed in the case, you'll get to know our analysis and our strategy going forward. And now, lawsuits. Now, there have been regular lawsuits which have been faced, like which the company has been facing in the years like 1996, 2005, 2010. But these are not significant according to my analysis, because it didn't affect the earnings that much as seen from the income statement given in the exhibit. And now the January 2012 lawsuit, which is quite significant, because analysts estimate that the compensation can amount to a few billion dollars to say even hundreds of billions of dollars. And now that is going to significantly impact the company. And according to my analysis, this is a bigger problem than the Chinese market. The Chinese market problem is more of, say, China, because China is a restrictive country. Even Facebook is not allowed to operate in China. So we have to live by that and accept that.
Now, after analyzing all the pros and cons of the case, we come up with three feasible strategies. Either we choose to play defensive, or we go on for an aggressive strategy in China. The third, that is the course of cooperation, we align with CUP and we work with CUP and extend our market base in China. Now these are the few courses which we can follow, where we could have followed the defensive play, so we could have been contented with what we have. We would have let the things run their own course, and maybe we could have got ahead by settling law cases or our lawsuits, ensure better business practices on our behalf, and wait for the WTO judgment to come into practice, offer low fees and the best flawless services possible to the Chinese consumers. That was the defensive play. Secondly, if we plan and go aggressive, we would cut ties from CUP. We would enter into a direct competition where we could compete against the CUP in the Chinese market. We would manage our cost. We would cut our fees and charges. We would extensively lobby with our government for the WTO judgment to be passed in a very fast manner and in our benefit. And the third, which is the course of cooperation, which we would like to suggest and propose, that we should follow the course of cooperation. That is, in a way, we cooperate with the CUP, align with them, and mend our ties with them, and subsequently in time, we adapt and develop according to the Chinese market. And so we, in a way, we are strengthening our arsenal so that we sit back and relax for now and prepare for the future and then strike back at the right time.
Okay, since a very large part of this case has also been devoted to the WTO judgment, we'd like to justify and tell you exactly why we're not pursuing this actively. There are a number of reasons. First of all, there's a very long wait for the resolution. And in that time, we do not know what our strategy would be. We cannot hope to succeed in such a competitive market with an ambiguous strategy. We have to act very proactively. Secondly, effort for pushing the case is already on. So whatever has to be done is already being done by the government. We feel that as Visa, one company does not have much of a role to play in WTO. Thirdly, lobbying for pursuing the case is already done. Again, something that's been done in the past, we cannot base our future actions on the result that's not even come yet. Fourthly, this is again to be handled by the US government. We cannot rely on the decision and we have to develop a strategy. And lastly, the administrative measures that are available with China ensure that even if we get a result in our favor, there will still be obstacles in our business in renminbi transactions. These are the reasons why we believe World Trade Organization's judgment should not perform a very significant part of our strategy.
Now, having decided the strategy is not enough. We have to justify the strategy, and in today's business world, finance speaks. We have to justify it financially, which is good for the shareholders, which is good for the operating policy, and it helps to reach efficiency, profitability, which are the main goals of the business. Now, if we come to the important numbers, the China analysis. In 2011, Asia Pacific was 27.7% of value of the credit card market or the transactions market. And China was 6.6% of that value. So, prima facie, China appears to be huge. One cannot ignore China. But we shouldn't get too much into China also, because it is a hostile environment to do business in. There are regulatory issues of the Communist Party. And we cannot just restrict ourselves because of that. So, but at the same time, there has been 154% growth in consumer card payments in the previous years, and it is poised to grow significantly. So, now justification for our strategy. China is just 6.6% of the total market, so we don't focus on it proactively. We just have a wait and watch approach, so that when the growth takes off later and after the cooperation with the CUP, we can cash onto the market when the regulatory issues maybe go away or it is easier to do business in China. And now, income statement analysis. Now, we calculated the CAGR, compounded annual growth rates. Now, the diluted EPS in the past few years, as given in the exhibit, has been growing at 75%, the net income at 65%, and the operating revenue at 13.6%. Now, from 2008 to 2009, if we notice the exhibit, there's a lot of cost reductions, say from around 5,000 to 3,000 million US dollars. And from 2009 to 2011, operating revenue has grown 33%, while operating expenses have just grown 10.6%. Now, this is indicative of the fact that the company has been doing good business in the past few years, despite the problem of lawsuits and other issues which it has been facing. So, financially, you justify our strategy of wait and watch, that in our global operations and in our US operations, where we have been doing good, we continue our same strategy, what we have been doing, which has given us such good results in the past few years. And as for China, we follow a wait and watch approach. Now, coming to the next slide. Implementation and control. Now, how do we exactly go about this strategy? First of all, if we have to look at China, with which the case deals primarily, we have to mend our ties with CUP, which went through a bit of rough weather in the past when it offered international services and started going global. But now, why will they again get back to us or enter into harmonious relationships? Because we are the largest company by value, and we are the market leaders in the online payment facilitation market. So, compared, though they are closer to MasterCard now, if we kind of have a proactive approach to get them back with us and cooperate, they would rather come back to us because we are the largest, and they can themselves offer the Chinese consumers better access when the Chinese travelers go abroad, and will have more international links if they associate it with us rather than MasterCard. And now, then we plan to have a Chinese top management. The top management in China should comprise of Chinese people who understand the Chinese market and know how to do business in China and have a keen understanding of the market. And plus, after having the Chinese management, we would like to build our networks in China with the intermediaries, with the bankers, with the regulatory institutions, etc. And focus on travelers, as again, because the Chinese travel market is also growing. There are a lot of outbound tourists from China abroad, and a lot of people are coming into China, and foreign exchange transactions are involved here. So we can offer help to CUP in this. Now, lawsuit management in US, which is a significant point, because if the compensation as estimated few billion dollars to hundreds of billion dollars, that could be a significant damage to the company. So we have to proactively engage in managing the lawsuit, get legal help and work out the systems, perhaps try and justifying our actions in the past, why this industry needs that, some sort of lobbying, etc. And now, study of legal systems and procedure in USA. Now, our strategy will be kind of dependent on our study of the legal system. If we see that in the past, any corrective action by such companies leads to a reduced compensation. Now, to explain further, if suppose now the company Visa decides to reduce the transaction cost and the commission which it charges in the US market, if that will kind of lead to a lower compensation verdict given by the court, then we might consider adopting that, slowly start decreasing the prices to kind of ensure that the court case doesn't get in our way. And if our study reveals that no, these things do not matter, and it is the past activities of the company which is going to determine the level or the quantum of lawsuits, which again we can just guess arbitrarily, then we'll pursue a wait and watch strategy again, and we'll see how it goes. But at the same time, we'll try to pursue and manage the court case and how exactly it goes. And now, cost management. Now, as we have been doing financially pretty well in the past, we'd like to continue with the same cost management policies, which has ensured that operating expenses are growing at a significantly lower rate than the operating income in the past few years, and continue with these control strategies, implementation, and the various management techniques the company has been practicing. Now, contingency. Now, there is a what-if analysis here for the Chinese market. Now, if the Chinese market opens up, now we have already forged our relationships in the Chinese market with the intermediaries, and then we are all set to tap into the market and go alone when the market opens up and the doing business in China is easier. Now, if the Chinese market doesn't open, then we haven't wasted much of our resources, energy, finances in trying to sort out the China problem, and we could have the advantage of sitting on to that amount of money, or basically we didn't waste extra resources for useless purpose. And now, for the US market, the lawsuit again, that is, we do not know how exactly to go. So our strategy for that will be that just to manage the lawsuit and try to get legal help to ensure that the compensation is at a reduced level or at a lower level, because if a higher compensation, say a few hundreds of billions of dollars, is made, then that will significantly impact the credit card companies, and Visa being the largest one in the US, it is going to significantly impact its operations and its future projections, because then the rates will come down and it will have to realign its business strategy. So we haven't thought of that far, but if that happens, then we'll have to realign our business model in the US, our main market, and go accordingly. But that is again situational, what kind of verdict comes from the court. So that's it pretty much.
Thank you,
Shrivan. Thank you so much. Now, our strategy, as we had three strategies, defensive, aggressive, and wait and watch, or the cooperative strategy. Now, the aggressive strategy would have required a lot more funds, and now we worked on the assumption that where exactly we are going to spend the money. First, in the lawsuit management in the US, now our assumption is that legal costs are kind of fixed. We have been handling lawsuits, antitrust laws in the past also, in 2010, 2006, and 1996. So that is a part and parcel of the business in which we are there. It happens like say every 4 years, kind of 4-5 years. So that will not significantly affect our working capital requirements or our operating expenses. So we considered that as part of the operating structure of our company. And that again will take care of our future operations, because a lawyer, I assume, will charge the same fees whether it is for this particular 2012 January lawsuit or any other previous lawsuits. And as for the Chinese operations, now, for the Chinese operations, again, we have been doing business, we have already established our place there. Now, the only thing which we are proposing to do differently in China is to perhaps get a Chinese management or a Chinese culture management into our top management, and then build links and understand the Chinese market, which again, I don't think we should have to make a significant provision for a company as big as visa with such huge turnover and such huge operating profits. And I think that can be taken care of by the usual operating ways, because those things are more of strategic initiatives rather than anything which is a significant investment or something. Basically, it is building relationships and understanding the market.
Thank you for the presentation. I like the way in which you analysed the market and also where China UnionPay was coming from, but I think you have to admit they're a significant threat to Visa's business model over time, particularly as the way they're expanding geographically and also reducing costs. So could you just explain a bit more about how you're going to collaborate with them? I think that's what your third strategy was, and why they would want to collaborate with Visa.
As I had already mentioned earlier, that we are the biggest facilitator in the online payment system, and we are the so this will be a significant advantage. Now, the status quo is that CUP is closer to MasterCard right now, but our strategy is that we are going to proactively engage with them, and we are going to pitch that we are the biggest company, and whatever is past is past. Earlier we cooperated, then there was a lean patch, but now again we want to have a fresh beginning and look at the future. Now we are the biggest company and China looks attractive to us, but we do not want to interfere in your way of doing business. We'll go by your rules. Okay, fine, you want to handle the renminbi transactions, we have no problems, but we'll handle the other aspects, the foreign exchange transactions, and give the international links to the local Chinese CUP. So that is basically our pitch, and we assume that this pitch is sufficient enough to convince them to come back to us, because that will give the Chinese consumers a larger reach in the international market as compared to MasterCard.
So it's really then a China outbound strategy. You'll work with them on Chinese individuals going outside of China, but leave the internal market.
Presently, because of the regulatory issues, we do not want to focus on the renminbi market right now. We would rather wait and watch for that and follow a passive strategy instead of actively pursuing it and trying to change the environment.
Okay. I think you have a dispute going on at the moment with CUP about the use of their cards outside of mainland China.
Yes.
Yeah. What would you do to resolve that dispute?
As for that, we plan that again in China, because the rates are significantly lower than what Visa is charging. So we'd like to kind of ensure that whatever they are like, come at an amicable agreement, that this is a proper rate, and have a revenue sharing agreement and work together for all the transactions being routed through their network. And basically we want to be together with them right now, and that's what we have decided.
No more questions, we'll end the Q&A session.
Thank you, Shrimram.
College of Commerce.